Live from the Sands Convention Center in Las Vegas, Nevada, it's The Cube at AWS reInvent 2014. Brought to you by headline sponsors Amazon and Trend Micro.
Hi everyone, welcome back. This is Jeff Frick. You're watching theCUBE. We're at AWS reInvent 2014 in Las Vegas, Nevada. This is our second reInvent. We've been to a number of summits and it's always a great show. Obviously AWS out front in the cloud space. This is a huge, I think there's over 300 exhibitors here. A giant show. I don't know what the people count is, but it's big and there's a lot of excitement. And we're really excited to have Jason Stowe on next, the CEO of Cycle Computing, CUBE alumni, who really is doing some very interesting stuff with software, leveraging AWS infrastructure to do things that people couldn't do before. So welcome back, Jason.
Thanks for having me, Jeff. It's so good to be here. So I'm always excited to be here at theCUBE.
Awesome.
This has been awesome.
So let's go ahead and talk about your most recent announcement that that you guys just came out with.
So we had a Fortune 500, it's HGST, which is a subsidiary of Western Digital. So they make the hard drives that are in most of the servers out there. And they're doing some really crazy engineering. So they have on the heads that actually read off the platters inside the disk drives, they had a million different designs. It was basically a parameter sweep of a bunch of different facets of how the head could possibly work that they wanted to simulate. The problem is it was 600 plus thousand hours of computing to do this. It would have taken a month in-house.
How many hours?
600 plus thousand, so it's about
630,000
hours.
640,000
hours.
To run the simulation.
So that's about 70 compute years. It's 70 and three-quarter compute years, so seven decades of computing that you would have been doing. And instead, we spun up a 70,000 core Ivy Bridge cluster on top of AWS, ran that workload. Instead of a month, it ran in 8 hours. And it got done for $5,594 on spot instances, which is just amazing, the cost compression there.
So one day, less than 6,000 bucks, they got to run their simulation.
Yeah, not even a day, a third of a day, 8 hours.
Right.
Yeah,
they get a working day.
Submit it in the morning, you get out at night,
right,
it's done.
Right. It's fantastic. And would they have even attempted that before, or is this just something outside the realm of possibility, or would they have done a more clunky kind of substandard process?
So this is something where, you know, they would still do it, but it would be one of those offline processes where they would maybe do less of it and they would also, you know, essentially start it and then stop a bunch of other work and come back a month later and try to figure out where they were, and it really makes the design process a little bit more challenging. So it really is an example of taking something like, you know, cooking a turkey that used to take 6 hours and you deep fry it, it takes half an hour. You know, it's that kind of transformation where it's a lot faster. It's the equivalent of the microwave.
Right.
And the cool thing about this cluster is, so it had 70,000 cores. It was what they call teraflops. So this is trillions of floating point operations per second. It had 729 of those teraflops. That's number 63 on the top 500 supercomputing list. So basically for an 8 hour window, we created a computing environment that was the equivalent to the 63rd best supercomputer on the planet, and then turned it back in, and it cost less than a single server to operate for a year. You know, that's the kind of cost compression and time compression. And what happens is when these come out, so in July, we had Novartis talk about a 10,000 server run they did. It ran about 40 years of computing in approximately 9 hours at a cost of $4,300. When that happens, then we get, you know, a Fortune 100 finance company that wants to run a regulatory workload at the end of every day that they just never would have done otherwise. Like, there's all kinds of use cases that fly out that just would never have happened. But because we're able to do this so quickly and so inexpensively, thanks to, you know, spot instances and cloud computing, it now becomes feasible. And this is really what's going to push humanity forward. It's going to make it so we have safer products. We're going to have better understanding of our genome. Novartis' use case was designing better cancer targets. So they basically had candidates for drugs. They found three of them in that 140-year run that ran in 9 hours. They found three new compounds that could be potential cancer drugs. as a result of that one run. And that's what we want. We want humanity doing things faster. We want to accelerate the human mind, get better answers faster. And cloud enables us to do that.
Yeah, and so like you said, I know a lot of your early customers were in pharmaceuticals and they're running simulations. But the HGST example is not pharma at all.
It's manufacturing.
It's manufacturing. So with these tremendous compressions in time and cost, you know, are people, do they get it? You know, what's kind of their plane in the, you know, for me, the Twitter moment was the plane in the Hudson, right? Where you could instantly find out what was going on Twitter.
That's right.
And that was like my, okay, now I get it, right? Get it. What's these guys kind of playing in the Hudson moment?
So I think this run for manufacturing will be that. We had, in life sciences, it took probably the second run that we did at large scale for people to be like, okay, yes, I get this, I understand why this is important. The guys, David Hines and Steve Philpott, Steve is the CIO and David runs global computing infrastructure, so basically data center and cloud computing engineering. For HGST, they get it. They are, I think, ahead of their industry a bit in terms of understanding that dynamic capacity can increase the throughput of your organization. There actually is going to be a talk on Friday here at reInvent, 10:30 in the morning. I think it's the BDT track, session 311, where David's going to talk about that workload that he did. Last year, we talked to you guys about the 156,000 core workload that ran, and after that, 156,000 core job where we did, you know, 2.3 million hours of computing in 18 hours. We got a ton of new users. Now running 10 to 20,000 cores is pretty normal.
Right.
And that's insane. The idea that you could just borrow 10 to 20,000 cores and then give them back when you're done is just ludicrous.
Well, the other thing though that's interesting that you just said is that it's not only simulations, but I think you mentioned some financial services firms using it for daily scheduled work, where before they wouldn't. So are you seeing more and more of an uptake of doing things that they would have either never done or at a frequency they would have never done using this capacity, low cost capacity?
So you have, Jeff Moore had a great paradigm around how technology gets adopted, wrote a book called Crossing the Chasm.
Right, of course.
You know, you have early adopters.
Right.
Yeah, you have the early majority, and then you have the late majority, and you have the Luddites, the guys that, you know, the only reason they don't have a phone with a, you know, a dial on it is because you don't sell them anymore, right? Exactly. So the thing about cloud and HPC is that life sciences was really the earliest adopter, right? So that happened in 2008, 2009, 2010.
Okay.
There was a lot of talk about it, et cetera. It started coming in. I think financial services and insurance has happened, you know, maybe a year, 2 years ago, and up through right now, it's kind of hitting its moment. And I think what's going on with manufacturing with HGST is really the leading, you know, you've got somebody that's visionary there. Steve actually has somewhat of a life sciences background in his career, and he's applying these things that have tremendous competitive advantage into HGST, and it's what they're doing is really impressive, frankly. And I think that that'll serve as a leader on the rest of manufacturing, and hopefully we'll see a lot more of exciting work going on.
Yeah, you know, and then as you said too, about moving downscale, you know, leveraging this capacity and this system to not necessarily have to do 70,000 cores or 150,000 cores, but to do 10 or 20 more frequently or smaller jobs. How's that adoption happening?
It's great, actually. So most of our customer base uses between 64 and 6400 cores. So they're really using, you know, tens, hundreds, and low thousands of bursts.
And what's the average duration of a job?
So I don't know, it depends on the industry.
Okay.
But generally what we're seeing is, you know, kind of daily fluctuation where you'll have, you know, peaks during the workday and it tones down at night.
Okay.
And then once every week or once every month, people realize, hey, you know, I can do a big run that'll run over the weekend on a larger core count. Over the weekend, I'll come back in on Monday and it's done. And normally I'd never even be able to run that run. And that's a pretty typical, I'd say, usage pattern, that during the day you get spikes where your internal cluster is topped, and so now I want to use a lot of cloud. And then over the weekends, people are saying, you know, I could actually run something much, much, much larger than that.
Right.
And then eventually that leads into, hey, you know, there is this workload, and the right scale, the right question is actually much larger than anything that would run internally at all. I'd have to stop everything, essentially. And that was the Novartis use case. That was the, you know, originally back in 2010, we did something with Genentech, where we ran a 10,000 core cluster, and people thought it was crazy at the time. And now we're talking, you know, 50, 70, 150,000 core clusters. And the great thing about this workload, honestly, from a cycle standpoint, we found out about it on Wednesday, and it ran this past weekend. So it was a couple of days, not a lot of prep. We basically got the environment up and running and pulled the trigger on it, and it ran. And so from a cycle standpoint, we really look at these as very, very doable.
Right.
And that kind of agility, when you're looking at it as a CIO, as a VP of engineering, or a chief science officer, being able to say, well, the bar or the problem I can approach economically is now not 100 cores. I can do problems that have tens of thousands of cores in
them.
Right. And I can get access to them. We got 50,000 cores from the spot guys at AWS. So this is, you know, Steve Philpott, and I want to give a shout out to Dave Pellerin, who's a BD for HPC, basically helps facilitate HPC workloads on AWS. They were like, sure, go ahead, dip your hand in the well and see what you come out with.
So what percentage of your workloads that are done with spot assets?
So I'd say,
and what are the keys to the economics?
Yeah, so spot is a big one. And I think what's going on is there's two classes of workloads. There's the ones that have to get done, and so on-demand and spot are used together in a mix. There's the ones that are essentially like, can we run this? And if it's anything shorter than 30 days, that's great, but if it's shorter than a day, then that means I don't have to stop thinking about the problem, I can come back to it. We have a lot of workloads like that where spot fits in great because there isn't necessarily the economics for those otherwise.
Right.
And then we have workloads that are more regularly planned where reserved instances make a lot of sense. And we want to use reserved, and then we might want to use a mix of either on-demand or spot on top of that. And the thing is, AWS gives you a lot of different options there, and I think the economic side of it, though, to get to your point, is the thing that's enabling people to do science that they never would have done before. You can now ask questions at the right scale, not the scale that fits on the cluster you could afford a year and a half ago. And that's a big deal,
right?
Especially when it comes to life sciences, when it comes to product design, when it comes to risk management. Those are the areas where we all want the safest possible car. We want, you know, the safest possible annuity, so that we get our retirement funds back. We want you to be thinking about cancer treatments that you might not otherwise think about. Those are the things where spot, I think, enables a lot of science that just would not happen otherwise.
And is most of the spot purchased from other people's unused capacity, or does Amazon have that much extra cores laying around that you can go in and put in an order for 70,000 on Wednesday and you're up and running on Saturday?
We found out about the workload on Wednesday. You know, when you're dealing with really large things that are above your AWS instance limit, you know, you have to let them know. So we let, you know, Dave Pellerin know and Steve Elliott know and Joby and a bunch of other guys on the AWS team, and they did whatever they do to make it so that, you know, our limits were high enough. And then, yeah, we just ran it. We didn't talk to them while we were running it at all. We didn't even do much manual work that much at all. Anyway, our software kind of just went in, grabbed all the core counts, ran the workload, shut itself down.
And again, your software really is the management layer that enables the orchestration of all this hardware under the covers.
So we have basically Cycle Cloud does orchestration, Cycle Server with a feature we call Submit Once, where you submit it once and it'll run in any region, does the distribution. So that ran parts of the workload in US West 1, US West 2, and US East in this case. We ran in three regions. And then we have Dataman, which does the data movement between internal environments and external environments and kind of handles that process for us. I think the key thing, getting back to where you were positing, is, you know, spot definitely is an enabler of experimentation.
Right.
And that's the mother of insight and the mother of invention, right? I mean, that's experimentation is what you want.
Right.
And because we were able to go in, get 70,000 cores, run it at $700 an hour, get the 63rd most powerful computer on the planet at the time to do it.
For 8 hours.
It's just amazing.
Right.
Yeah, that's really amazing. And I think it's going to be transformative to what happens in science and engineering and risk management. a lot of fields, basically everybody now is doing technical computing. I would actually say that, you know, people don't worry about websites and emails. You know, how do I deploy that as a CIO? I don't care about that anymore. I don't care about as much about the ERP and the CRM systems. You know, sure, you know, deploying SAP properly is an important goal, but the workload that's hard now is the tens and hundreds of servers that are in analytics and big data, in simulation and HPC. All of those areas are the areas, the technical computing workloads are the new enterprise workload.
Which is really because the economics enable it in a way that wasn't possible before,
exactly.
Right? I mean,
that's
they
right.
had a lot of those questions, they just couldn't afford to answer them. Or the ROI wasn't necessarily there.
And the competitive advantage you get out of understanding, all right, this is the drive head that'll enable me to get more data off the platter faster,
right.
So I can
right.
have a 20 terabyte drive that does an amazing job. Like, that kind of science yields business benefits.
Right.
And that's really what technology is all about, is enabling us to be able to solve problems we can never solve before.
Awesome. Well, Jason, thanks for stopping by again. We're getting
thanks for having us.
The hook again. Jeff Frick here at theCUBE. We're at AWS reInvent 2014. We'll be here today, Wednesday, Thursday, going wall to wall, getting the smartest people in the room, asking them the questions that you wish you could ask them, and bringing it to you live.
Yeah, and if I can just ask one question, Jeff.
Sure.
Are you guys going to do March Madness again this year?
I think, where's Greg? Yeah, we're doing March Madness.
Rock on, that was so awesome.
And Jason won, of course, as you may have
Hopefully I can sit from the sidelines this year, because it was competition, it's fierce.
It was good, March Madness. Check it out on SiliconANGLE.TV. Just Google Cube Madness. All right, Jeff Frick signing off.